The BTS programming model is very simple and straightforward. It's a distributed application, and in the distributed application, there are threads and channels. These are the two high-level abstractions provided in the programming model. And the computational graph that you generate using the PTS programming model, in particular the abstractions thread and channel provided by the PTS programming model, the computation graph looks very similar to a Unix process socket graph. So in terms of a transition for a programmer that is familiar with the socket API to transition to programming using the abstractions provided by PTS is not significant. While the computation graph looks similar to a process socket graph, the semantics of the channel abstraction is very different from the socket abstraction. In particular, what the channel holds are time-sequenced data objects. So a thread is generating time-sequenced data objects, can place those time-sequenced data objects into the channel. The other thing you would also notice from the structure of this computation graph that there could be multiple producers of data that go into a given channel, and similarly there could be multiple consumers of data that are getting data from a given channel. Or in other words, the channel allows many-to-many connections. A thread that produces some data and wants to put it into a channel uses the primitive provided for operating on the channel, namely the putItem primitive. And the putItem takes two arguments. One is the item itself, which is whatever the application decides as the content of the data that it wants to put in a channel. There's a timestamp that it can associate with the data that it is producing and placing in the channel. So if you look at the contents of any given channel, it's really showing a temporal evolution of data that is being produced by a particular thread. For example, this thread could be capturing data from a camera, and every item that it produces is one frame of image captured from the camera associated with the wall clock time at which that particular frame was captured. A computation that is needing to use the data will do a get on a channel, and when it does a get on a channel, it actually has to specify two arguments. One is a lower bound for a timestamp that it is looking for, and an upper bound. In other words, a thread that wishes to get data from this channel, for instance, will specify in the get primitive that I want to get the data that is in a particular channel starting at a particular time, say 1:05 p.m., to an upper bound 1:06 p.m. And what the thread is going to get back is all the items that this channel contains between this lower bound and upper bound. The programming model also allows an application to specify time variables in an abstract way. It could say, I want the oldest item from a channel, or the newest item from the channel, in addition to specifying explicit lower bound and upper bound markers, if it so chooses. So in other words, a channel contains a continuous stream of data that have been snapshotted with different timestamps associated with them. So this is the way one could write a program that uses the primitives provided by the PTS programming model. Let's say we are writing the code for a detector that is looking at video stream produced by a particular camera. In that case, the detector will associate a variable channel 1 with the video stream that corresponds to what that camera is producing. And continuously, what it is going to do is it is going to get a camera image from that particular channel, and it might specify a lower bound and an upper bound in terms of time that it is looking for, process the data, produce an output, and it might place the output that it produced as a digest of information that it processed into another channel. And it'll do that by putting the digest as a new item and associate a timestamp. This is a place where the programming model facilitates temporal causality to be propagated in the distributed system. So if this thread is a detector thread that is looking at the camera images produced by a camera thread, then it can take the camera images, process it, and place it in its output channel. And when it places it in the output channel, it can use the same timestamp that it got for an input image in doing the put operation. And that way, there is temporal causality that is being propagated through this graph by the computation using the primitives that is available from this PTS programming system. Quite often, in situation awareness application, the computation may have to use data from several different streams in order to do its high-level inferencing. So a particular thread may get information from several different streams, and it may have to make high-level inference based on the composite results that it is getting from all these streams. And since all the data that is coming from the channels have timestamps associated with them, an intermediate computation like this that is taking multiple streams and generating a high-level inference from it can use the timestamps in the incoming streams to see which data items in these streams are temporally correlated with one another and use that information to improve the kind of inferencing and hypothesis that can be derived in the situation awareness application. So in a nutshell, the PTS programming model, what it allows is the ability to associate timestamp with data items produced by a computation. So the model allows propagation of temporal causality because of the fact that a computation can associate a timestamp with an item that it produces based on the timestamp that it got on the data that it obtained from its input channel. And thirdly, the fact that every stream is temporally indexed allows a computation to correlate the incoming streams and recognize which data items in the input streams are temporally related to one another by looking at the timestamps associated with the items that it is fetching from the different channels.